Thank you very much, Meenakshi, Indiraji, Keki, one of my oldest friends, and everyone here, of course, but all the trustees of the Sarvodaya International Trust. I'm hugely honored to be here. It's very, very moving to be present at something that celebrates possibly the greatest resistor human being model that we have had in this country, that we had the great fortune of having had in this country. And it is particularly moving for me to be here today because we are passing through a time of extraordinary violence on a daily basis, where practically every value that the Mahatma held is being violated and celebrated by, of course, those who have no time for what he believed in, what he laid his life down for. I'm certainly not going to be able to contribute in any very major way to that, but I thought it is very appropriate for us to try and revive that now, to somehow insist that what he believed in and what he stood for are essential for us to recover if there is to be any kind of harmony or peace or equality or dignity or humanity or compassion, indeed, in our lives, both personal and political. So I'd like to thank the Trust for inviting me to speak. I'm very humble in this endeavor. I have never done a keynote in my life, so please indulge me. And I hope that I will be able to speak a little bit about what it means when women try to wage peace. I'm going to begin with a poem by a woman poet from the Northeast, whose name is Mamang Dai. It's only part of a poem, but I'll read out the latter part. From the east, the warrior returns with the blood of peonies. I am the child who died at the edge of the world, the distance between end and hope. The star diagram that fell from the sky, the summer that makes men weep. I am the woman lost in translation who survives with happiness to carry on. I am the breath that opens the mouth of the canyon, the sunlight on the tips of trees, there where the narrow gorge hastens the wind. I am the place where memory escapes the myth of time. I am the sleep in the mind of the mountain. Mamang Dai is an Arunachali poet living in a region that has experienced protracted violence for a very, very long time, like much of Northeast India. Manipur, Nagaland, Arunachal, Meghalaya, Assam have been under the Armed Forces Special Powers Act for an almost continuous period since the mid-1990s. Armed violence, the fact of it, the apprehension of it, and the experience of it is an almost everyday reality in many parts of the Northeast, as it is in several other parts of our country. How do people, men and women without resources and the means to overcome this everyday violence, resist? How do they deal with the far superior and brutal power of those who wield their weapons against them? What possible recourse is available to them. A similar predicament and equally urgent questions would have presented themselves to Gandhiji when he was confronted by the firepower and apparently invincible strength of the imperial power in India. It was his particular genius, but also his principled rejection of violence as a means of resistance, as a strategy, and as a justification that he brought to bear the moral and ethical power of nonviolence on his struggle and to face the bullets of the British with the only weapon he was willing to use, his unarmed body. Since then, but especially in the recent past, there has been an almost exponential increase in the scale and kinds of violence, social, political, communal, caste, and gender across the country. For the most part, ordinary men and women find themselves caught in the crossfire between competing violences, a numbing cycle of reprisal and retaliation, of provocation and repression. In India, as in much of South Asia, these cycles of violence are both sporadic and protracted. Sporadic in some cases, protracted in others, so that we are never in a post-conflict period. There is no real cessation of violence, and peace remains elusive. If, following the Mahatma, we have a principled objection to the use of violence in all its forms, as a means not only of domination and control, but as a strategy for resolving conflict. If, like him, we believe that far from being passive, nonviolence is an active form of resistance, and what is more, is not for the faint-hearted. If we eschew violent resistance, even in the face of brutal oppression, then by what means and in what manner do we confront these multiple violences? Although there is a great deal one can say about the current violence, I would like to focus on how women who have been resisting violence for a very long time now have done so not only non-violently, but publicly, and have presented what is, in my view, the most sustained form of non-violent resistance against violence in situations of armed conflict. I focus on armed conflict because it was, of course, the armed power of the British that Gandhiji first needed to address. On July 11, 2004, at 3:30 p.m., Hawaldar Suresh Kumar in Imphal, in Manipur, signed a memo stating that he was arresting Thangjam Manorama Devi, 32 years old, quote, a suspected insurgent, explosives expert, and hardcore member, unquote, of the banned People's Liberation Army. 3 hours later, she was found dead, having been raped and shot in her vagina. Nearly 6 kilometers from where Manorama's body was found, lay Iram Sharmila, who had been on an indefinite fast, refusing to eat a morsel since November 2000 in protest against the Armed Forces Special Powers Act in force in Manipur since 1980. On July 15th, 4 days after Manorama was killed, the entire country was stunned to see photographs in the national press of a most extraordinary protest by women. 15 middle-aged women demonstrated naked in front of the gates of Kangla Fort which was the headquarters of the 17 Assam Rifles, in Imphal, shouting, "Indian Army, rape us." 75-year-old Thokchom Ramani, Secretary of the Women's Social Reformation and Development Samaj, said, "Our anger made us shed our inhibitions that day. If necessary, we will die, commit self-immolation to serve our innocent sons and daughters." For over 3 months, the state of Manipur was in turmoil with frequent strikes, bans, protests, and demonstrations demanding that the AFSPA be revoked. Reacting to a spate of custodial and encounter killings, people's anger and resentment flared across the street at the central government's perceived indifference to their demand for punishing the guilty and revoking the act by Independence Day 2004. Strikes and work stoppages were widespread as protesters took to the streets. Activists of the women's group, the Mera Paibis, or the Torchbearers, marched in a candlelight procession through Imphal, and Apunba Loop, an umbrella group of 32 civil and human rights organizations, called for civil disobedience, recalling Gandhi against the AFSPA. Manorama's house became a virtual shrine, uniting activism, activists, and ordinary people against the act. There is a kind of cliche that says men make war and women make peace. Women are generally supposed to be nurturing and caring, naturally maternal, even Gandhi believed that, and therefore predisposed towards peace, just as men are supposed to be the opposite. Women are more open to mediation, to negotiation and compromise, because it has been suggested they are obliged to carry on the business of survival and sustenance when all social and economic supports have broken down. And they are often obliged to do so in the absence of their menfolk. So they are more likely to be found caring for the sick or wounded, in relief and rehabilitation, and in rebuilding communities, than carrying guns and going into combat. Because they are also among the worst sufferers in any situation of conflict, armed or otherwise, they are believed to be more inclined towards peace. Feminist analysis has tried to move away from biological, essentialist, and culturalist arguments in favor of women's tolerance and nonviolence, and suggested instead that if women have a distinctive angle in peace, it is not due to their being nurturing, but more to do, perhaps, with knowing oppression. Their historical exclusion from structures of power, both in the private and public domains, as well as their experience of subjugation, gives them a stake in working for peace and justice, or a just peace, as well as in keeping democracy alive. For it is only through social justice and democracy that they will be able to realize their right to equality. According to this logic, a feminist culture of peace fundamentally criticizes unequal structures of domination and is built on learning to live with difference, without aggression. In other words, non-violently. I would like to suggest an additional factor that may be at work in women's peace activism, and this is their particular gendered experience of violence in war, but also in supposed peace. As recent empirical work the world over has shown, for women, the weapons of war are much the same as the weapons of peace. Those who wield them in the battlefield or on the front often return home and turn the violence inwards. Women have first-hand knowledge of the connected forms of domestic, communal, and political violence that stretches from the home to the street and into the battlefield. In earlier work, I have spoken of this with regard to the partition violence in India in 1947. Similarly, studies of post-Yugoslavia, Bosnia, Israel-Palestine, Ireland, and closer home, Kashmir, Jaffna, Karachi, Dhaka, the northeast of India, demonstrate the links between militarization, misogyny, and domestic violence. By the way, we can see this misogyny at work in all the protests around Padmavati and the Karni Sena, but that's a slightly different issue, although not very. It is the combined experience of oppression and violence, plus the responsibility for survival and sustenance during and in the aftermath of conflict, that I believe provides the strongest impetus to women's peacemaking. In Kashmir, Parveena Ahangar's search for her missing son eventually led to the formation of the Association of the Parents of Disappeared Persons and to a cry for collective justice. The refusal of the women of Kunan Poshpora to remain silent about their rape by the Indian security forces led to the highlighting of military atrocities. The public cursing of the Mothers' Front in Sri Lanka forced the government into acknowledging its role in the disappearance of thousands of young JVPers in Sri Lanka. The women in black, the Madres of the Plaza de Mayo, the Jaffna Mothers' Front, take their private sorrow and make it public, thus not only radicalizing the personal, but radicalizing even motherhood, shaming the institutional and the authoritarian. Women's construction of the legitimacy or illegitimacy of conflict is a critical factor in women turning their backs on it. In Kashmir, for instance, a turning point in the armed struggle came when Kashmiri women began to shut the door on militants. But is there such a thing as women's practice of peace? Do we do peace differently from other peace activists? And if so, are these alternative practices effective in the long run? Can they, for instance, work across borders, national as well as regional? As with economic activity in South Asia, in peace work too, women belong in the informal sector. The informal spaces of politics, which by its very nature affects our practice. The ritualized cursing of the Mothers' Front or the sustained protest by the mothers of the Plaza de Mayo, indeed the public mobilization of motherhood in the cause of peace and as a direct challenge to the state, are quintessentially womanist forms of peace activism. Bearing witness, as happens in the world courts on violence against women and in various tribunals on violence or other crimes, is not womanist in the same way, but it has radicalized the hitherto marginal and powerless, and forced public and institutional notice outside the traditional arenas of such activity, which is the court, the police station, the executive, or the bureaucracy, radicalizing the protest and moving it outside these traditional arenas is a particular contribution of women's peace activism. Dialogue and networking have been among the most effective strategies used by the global women's movement in working for social change as well as in raising awareness. Dialogue that bridges difference and is predicated on respecting that difference is at the other end of the spectrum from what another analyst of conflict, Ranabir Samadar, calls maximalist friendship. Such a friendship, he says, like Cold War friendship, depends on maximum enmity and then maximum hostility. Far from being conducive to peace, it kills understanding. The alternative to this is accommodating difference, which more than solidarity requires a politics of understanding. And it is this politics of understanding that I believe women in the region, that is the South Asian region, are trying to forge. Cynthia Coburn, a British peace activist, describing a few notable examples of cross-border peace initiatives by women in Ireland, Israel, and Bosnia-Herzegovina, identifies six characteristics that she believes made the difference between women's efforts and others. They are, one, affirming difference. Two, non-closure of identity. Three, reducing polarization by emphasizing other differences. Four, an acknowledgement of injustice. Five, defining the agenda. And six, group process. Again, these may not be essentially womanist ways of doing peace, but they have been worked at successfully by the three groups she studied, and they are clearly different from conventional confidence-building measures, two-track, and other people-to-people dialogues. Coburn also draws attention to the importance of recognizing what she calls the space between us in peace work. That social and political space in which we separately live and work in order to craft a politics of understanding. It is not easy to do. In Sri Lanka, for example, the Jaffna Mothers Front and the Sinhala Mothers Front were unable to cross the ethnic divide. Nor in the Northeast could the Naga Mothers Association make common cause with the Watsu Mongdung in the Northeast. Occasionally, women's groups may come together on specific issue, as groups did in Bangladesh with the Hill Women's Federation, but they parted company on issues of national identity. One unexpected instance of successful bridge building, however, was that of the MQM in Karachi and the Women's Action Forum. But the crucial point is that women's fledgling attempts at making peace have highlighted the necessity of transparency and democratic process in any peace accord or negotiation that will endure. The inclusion of marginal and hitherto unheard voices in this process, painstaking and protracted though it may be, may actually have a better chance of succeeding than that peace reached through force or subjugation. We can see that most poignantly in northern Sri Lanka today. The range of protests that women have used in situations of armed conflict and violence have varied in form and content, from conventional demonstrations and rallies to vows of silence, hunger strikes, and the more extreme fasts unto death, like Irom Sharmila's. Unconventionally, women have also protested and marked their resistance in more individual and symbolic ways by, for example, refusing to change out of the clothes they were wearing when abducted in the aftermath of the partition of India, or wearing their hair loose during the entire period of mourning for their slain husbands and menfolk in the wake of Mrs. Gandhi's assassination in 1984. Veena Das quotes the widows of Sultanpuri as saying, and I quote, "They have asked us to clean up our houses and to go in and settle down. How can we settle down here? Do you see the heaps of ashes? Do you see the blood? Here, put your hand inside this heap and you will see the melted skulls. They would not even let us have the dead bodies. We begged them. You have killed our men. Let us have their bodies at least. Let us mourn them properly." Unquote. Not only did the women make their mourning public, they defiantly hung on to their filth and their pollution. They would not go into their houses. They would not light the hearth, and they would not change their clothes. In other words, they refused to return to normalcy, to resume their daily lives. In more collective forms of resistance and in protest against the disappearance of their sons, mothers in Sri Lanka and in Kashmir have asserted motherhood in order to shame the authorities into recognizing their status as wronged mothers, demanding information on their children's whereabouts. Elizabeth Helene, who has worked on the mothers of the Plaza de Mayo and especially on the extreme violence in the southern cone of Latin America, has said of those protests, and I quote, "Mothers, relatives, grandmothers, and widows erupted in the public arena as the bearers of social memory and of human rights violations." In the very first novel that Nayanthara Sehgal wrote, called A Time to be Happy, the mother of a young revolutionary, assured of certain death, says, and I quote, "The Mahatma, when he preached nonviolence, understood many things, but the greatest of these was his understanding of a mother's heart," unquote. But the July 15th protest by 15 Meitei women was a radically and profoundly different kind of challenge to the state, and in sharp and shocking contrast to Irom Sharmila's fast against the AFSPA. Sharmila's protest, like other fasts unto death, offers up her own body in the cause of justice. The Meitei women, on the other hand, publicly presented their naked bodies as a rebuke. "Indian army, rape us," they shouted, challenging the authorities by drawing graphic attention to the shameful violation of women's bodies by them. By saying, "We are Manorama's mothers," they as good as declared that her rape was tantamount to raping them, and by extension, all Manipuri women and all mothers. As sacrilege, the rape of the mother is the most unpardonable violation, yet the 15 women expose their naked bodies as the ultimate in self-abnegation and in symbolic recognition of the threat of rape as the power of all men over all women. At another level, however, their protest redefined the hitherto unbridgeable distance between the armed forces and the citizenry by forcing the attention of both upon themselves. The all-women's group, the Mera Paibis, has been one of the most important social organizations in Manipur to resist a wide range of social ills. It was formed initially to mobilize women against alcoholism and rowdyism among Manipuri women, men. But it has since extended to activities to take in other social issues, especially the increasing militarization of the state. Among other things, the Mera Paibis have consistently opposed the AFSPA. They have demonstrated, fasted, held protest meetings, and systematically brought abuses by the armed forces to public notice. They have taken up rape cases and volunteered legal help. They have even mediated with the army on occasion and organized public meetings with them, and they have intervened between civil society and underground groups. Soldiers in Sarong, a film made on the Mera Paibis, powerfully communicates the steady resolve of the women in the face of recurrent brutality. These are ordinary women, by no means radical or even subversive, yet they remain undeterred in their demand for the withdrawal of the Armed Forces Special Powers Act from Manipur, which is still in force. The abiding image from the film is of the torch-bearing Mera Paibis, the human and female face of a militarized state on one side, and of the military in full display of their masculinity on the other. Men dominate the institutional aspects and structures of conflict. Women, children, and feminized men are its dominated other. Repression itself, as Elizabeth Helene has eloquently elaborated, is gendered, carried out by masculine and patriarchal institutions, the armed forces and the police. Rituals of power in the public sphere, she says, unambiguously stage the opposition between the active, empowered, masculine subject and the passive, excluded, feminized audience. Audience, not just women. An audience that may at times involve the entire civilian population. Personalized symbols of pain and suffering tend to be embodied in women, while repressive mechanisms appear to belong to men. The teenage face of Zahira Sheikh, her pigtails framing it on either side, has almost become synonymous with the Gujarat massacres of 2002, just as the predominant images from Kashmir, whether of militants or the armed forces, are those of violent armed confrontation. Counterposed against the fear-inducing and power regalia of the armed forces, the uniforms, the weaponry, the parades and patrols, all of which we saw yesterday, are the feminine objects of resistance used by women: candles, flowers, scarves and diapers, and photographs. Mamang Dai's poem, with which I began, written at the height of conflict in the Northeast, is not only a repudiation of violence, whether by insurgents or by the armed forces, it is a refusal to succumb or to give up hope, and at the same time, It is an affirmation of the power of nonviolent resistance. I am the woman, she says, who survives with happiness to carry on. I am the breath that opens the mouth of the canyon. Thank you.